says I'm supposed to give a keynote. I'm just going to touch on a variety of things and also urge people to go to GoFundMe.com and donate to take back the vote, because this has to be an ongoing social movement. It's fairly absurd that we're fighting the same battles that we thought we won in this country, you know, back in the 1920s for women, and at least in 65 for the black population. And now they're doing it to everyone. Well, not just everyone. It seems like they target Sanders voters from everything we did, people that were challenging the status quo. I just want to speak briefly about three things. Number one, part of the reason they can do these things is the propaganda assumption that we're the greatest democracy in the world, we're the longest standing. I have a PhD in political science, so they pay me to keep track of this. I'll be the first to admit we're in the top quarter, right? There's about 50 long-standing democracies. The last major study showed we were 47 out of 47. So we're really kind of kicking butt when it comes to military dictatorships in other parts of the world. Again, we do a variety of things quite poorly. The worst of which, and if I had my book here, I didn't bring it up, but the strip and flip election in 2016, right? Unlike the European Union, where there's a constitutional right to vote, we have no constitutional right to vote in the United States. And in fact, we were built on allowing only a certain segment of the population to vote from the beginning. So in one sense, we have only been a democracy, and now we've retreated from that. I agree with Jimmy Carter, right, when he said we're a dysfunctional democracy, when he told Der Spiegel, you know, what's the state of American democracy? Well, it's dysfunctional. It's not a functioning democracy. So we were 47 out of 47. And part of it, in Europe, it's the government's obligation to, in fact, register you to vote and to guarantee your right to vote. We have, the subtitle on this is the five Jim Crows, right? We have a Jim Crow system, a state-based system. 50 states decide, you know, how the voting procedure works. And in Ohio, I'm from, John Houston, Republican, just came up with a new wrinkle, that if you didn't vote in 2012 and 2014, you should be likely purged from the voting rolls, because there's an old Ohio law that says if you haven't voted in 4 years, you should, in state elections, and another one they're interpreting federal elections, you shouldn't be allowed to vote. Also, if you've moved, you don't get, he sent out these applications for mail-in voting. He left 1,035,000 known registered voters off the voting polls. People who didn't vote 2 years ago, he left off. Surprisingly, they appear to be disproportionately black and minority and poor. So that's happening as we speak. And I also encourage you to get a chance to look at Greg Palace's a new documentary. I don't know, some of you writers actually showed it in this area. Who's seen that? But the, of course, a much higher percentage than anywhere else. So again, this question that I'm gonna pose to you, this is one I pose, but the Secretary of State in Ohio refuses to answer. In a state like Ohio that requires you can use 17 forms of ID to show your address in order to vote, that's one of those 50 systems. In that scenario, in a computer age, why would you purge or eliminate anyone's vote when they have to show you ID to match where they're gonna vote? I mean, what, there isn't enough room on the computer, right? The hard drive's not big enough? I mean, why? And in fact, Ohio is only a swing state. because of these massive voter purges. You know, the million that they're now targeting, but 1.1 million in 2012, 1.25 million in 2008, and over 305,000 one year prior to the 2004 election, including 24.96% of every single voter in Cleveland, Ohio, which voted 81% for John Kerry. If Kerry had won Ohio, he would have been the president. If it wasn't for the stripping, these mass purges, and remember the DNC leaks have now suggested that when it came down to upload and report the databases in many areas of the United States, conveniently many of the strong Sanders supporters were accidentally left out conveniently glitched. So we've got ongoing problems. Why can't we have a universal voting right in the United States? And the other problem, the flip part, I'll just briefly, we all know what that's about or you wouldn't be here, right? And as I said over and over again, it's faith-based voting. It's push and pray, right? You hope there's some intervention from the Holy Spirit, particularly when you see the vote flip in front of you, right? I mean, this happened in Ohio in 2004. We were kind of first, and sad. I feel bad for the programmers because they've now gotten better, and you see, you know, it doesn't flip in front of you quite as much. But in Youngstown, Ohio, they had to admit that 31 machines were in fact flipping. But, you know, what was the harm? In Franklin County, they didn't flip them. I have more respect for them. The Kerry vote just faded away. We called it the Franklin County fade. You'd push for it, and you'd go, okay, time to... You look up and go, Kerry vote's off. So you're in this thing where people had to contort, like, keep your hand on it and reaching over here for the button. I just hope your timing was good enough so you could actually record your vote. So keeping that in mind, the third and last thing that besides the strip and flip is some of you know I sued the monopoly pollsters, Edison Research, and they just responded again yesterday. We'll see if we can survive in the courts. They work for a cartel, right? The four broadcast networks, Fox, NBC, ABC, CBS, as well as CNN and AP. And we argued that they're in collusion, right? Because they take, no matter what their polling numbers say with the unadjusted polling, they are gonna take the state's official vote count, even though it's absolutely statistically improbable. You know, when I was in working on my PhD in political science, you know, they required we take PhD theoretical stats as well as applied statistics at the master's and the PhD level. But one of the things that I had an old school teacher who used to teach us this acronym, his system, right? If the polls are so far off, you're shaking your head, you look at was there historical intervention? Did something happen, you know, and it's really hard with an exit poll because it would have to be when you walked in to vote and when you walked out. Exit polls tend to be the most accurate because you're not asking people how they're going to vote, but how they just voted. So in that scenario, the second thing you go to, the his, mister, the second part is instrumentation. If your numbers are real far off, you actually look at your instrument, right? If it doesn't predict an earthquake and your seismic equipment should have, you see if the thing's recording right. You make sure that it's operational. It's the same thing with a voting machine, right? If people are saying, damn, the vote flipped right in front of my eyes, that may be an indication that there's bad programming. Or if it's shutting down, or if it's coming up with numbers. And again, I was given great credit, having a PhD in statistics in Ohio. I was able to figure out when in Clyde, Ohio in 2004, for the vote came in at 131%. I was able to figure out that there may be some problem with the vote process and perhaps the central tabulators. 102 precincts in Perry County, 120 and 124%. So, again, if you allow private, for-profit, partisan companies to secretly program your computers to vote out of your central tabulators and help with the online recording, and nobody knows what's in their code. It's not open source. They're not turning on any of the logs, which happened in Ohio. We saw three vote flips in November 15th in the legalized marijuana initiative, and we called up and said, we think we saw vote flips. Can we get the audit logs? And they said, well, you know, we think that's just human error. I'm going, what, you got hundreds of people putting in stuff? This stuff's coming on a computer feed. We want the audit logs. And they said, well, we you know, we were saving money. We didn't turn them on. It's an electronic feature. Exactly how much money did you save? A quarter of a cent in electricity? Or, I mean, the stories are just so implausible. So I think it's up to us to demand that full transparency in elections. It's our agenda to drive the partisan for-profit companies out of the business where they don't belong, in the business counting the people's votes. And I think that's why we're here today, and we're no longer fooled by their stories. And trust us, you know, trust the guy behind the black curtain with the black box, even if none of it makes sense. No one would ever cheat. The last thing, right? Studies indicate people always cheat. Studies of voting behavior. People cheat for sixth grade class president. They cheat for homecoming queen. They cheat for college president. People cheat if a system allows them to cheat. And ours has big neon signs that says, come in and jack the vote. Particularly if you're a partisan, rich company connected to powerful people. So let's make sure our elections are fully transparent. Let's educate each other today in the finest tradition of communitarian democracy. And let's make sure there's never another coup d'etat in California.
Right on.
Well, I think part of that has to do with what happened in 2000 when the vote was stolen in Florida. The notion that if you call American democracy into question, if you suggest votes can be stolen, it makes you a sore loser man, right? And that part of that process. Also, Kerry was concerned. I actually briefed John Kerry a few days after I was the attorney for Jesse Jackson and represented him in a lawsuit, Moss v. Bush, which he was one of the plaintiffs along with William Moss, an elected school board member. But Kerry had a few questions. We told him about the machines flipping. And he said, yeah, the same thing happened in New Mexico. So he was absolutely aware of what was going on. I asked that operative who was doing polling on the ground, was the election stolen? And he was told yes. Kerry's next statement is, can I prove it in 72 hours? And he said, no, right? The ballots are locked down for 10 days. Discretion of the Secretary of State. They're just going to be doing their preliminary count. There's no way. Our systems are designed to be stolen. They're not designed to immediately remedy obvious theft and irregularities. You know, I'm a firm believer we ought to carry yellow tape and, you know, kind of wall off certain precincts and make calls to the police and bring in forensic computer experts when you know the vote is flipping or irregularities are going on. And I've had the police called on me, and I was thankful for it because it meant someone came out when there was too many provisionals in driving park. When 100 straight black men came in, and some of them yelling, "But I'm in the book," and they're sending them over to the provisional table. I was there as an election observer for the Green Party at the time, and I did what I hope and I know all of you would do. I told the presiding judge, "You're a criminal. You're committing criminal acts. You need to be arrested." He called the cops on me, but I planned in advance. I had a former black race car driver, Michael Reese, waiting outside, and I sped away. But I did two things. Number one, I invited in the foreign media that was outside. There just happened to be some reporters out there from Germany. And I said, "Why don't you guys come in and film this?" Which they did. And the other thing is the Justice Department showed up before the police did. Is that the Justice Department in 2012 was in Ohio. But I think the assumption, you know, other than, you know, the oddity of they were both in Skull and Bones and in a secret society they couldn't talk about, it's almost like this gentleman's agreement is like, "Oh, you got me this time with that new electronic vote thing. We'll have to figure out how to counter that by getting more voters out." It's almost an agreement that you don't call the world's worst election system. And the Harvard study and the study from they co-did it with the University of Australia in Sydney says we're the absolute worst in terms of denying people the right to vote, security of the election. So, you know, non-competitiveness, 90% of our congressional system. So even though we're the worst, the assumption is you can't, if you're good, one of the elite of either party, you can't call the American system into question. But since we're reality-based, right? And we're not coincidence theorists, you know, the coincidence theorist is like, "Oh yeah, 31 machines were flipping the vote and they forgot to put out, 42 precincts that were all black, the machines, it was an accident, someone accidentally blacked them out, and there accidentally happened to be 4,000 extra votes and people voted for Bush and Gahanna Ward 1B. At a certain point, you know, when we see about 20 or 30 consecutive coincidences, we're not afraid to, you know, to say maybe there was a conspiracy. Maybe more than one person, that's all a conspiracy is. Maybe a couple people are trying to rig the damn election, right? So we're not gonna say, no, that's just a coincidence. So what, 10,000 voters got glitched 2 weeks out in Cleveland? A coincidence. So what, 305,000 voters, including those in Toledo, Cincinnati, all in the inner city? That's a coincidence. Maybe the fact that all these strong Sanders voters in Brooklyn and California all, you know, got an NPP ballot. It's just a coincidence. And you're going, "Well, what about those DNC leaks? It looks like they were targeted. It does not look like a coincidence." So let us not be coincidence theorists when we're in a power struggle and really lives are at stake. Because there's probably, you know, there's 5 million Iraqi refugees now as a result of that election in 2004 going wrong. There's probably 1.5 million Iraqis that are dead. There's the rise of ISIS. There's the bizarre removal in Libya, of course, of Gaddafi, which has led to massive unrest. Is that the stakes are so massively high when you're in the new Rome, right? Is that if we're realists, we've got to admit, you know, we're an empire. If we've got troops in 181 out of 203 nations, the stakes are too high not to allow alternative candidates, those with visions, those who want social revolutions, to be fairly treated. So that's really upon us to expose this. And I think we've won to some extent that battle. When the New York Times runs an op-ed saying, sure, it's going to be hacked. Sadly, it took Donald Trump and blaming the Russians, which is bizarre. Sure, they may be tapping into some database of voters, but private companies, CEIC, ES&S, have the keys to the kingdom, right? They write the codes and secretly cannot be allowed, must be stopped, has to be open source, have to return to ballots that are on paper. And it looks like I'm at the time where I'm past. Thanks a lot. All right, so let me introduce, and I'll be speaking for 15 minutes later. I know I saw some questions back there. But now the first panel will be on poll workers' experience during the June coup d'etat. Mario Roberto Morataya, Richard Corte, Richard Tamm, and Kelsy Presnall. Their experience. I look forward to hearing it.
So before this election, that was me. I had no interest in it whatsoever. And then obviously this election, Bernie Sanders came along, and he had a tremendous appeal with the millennial population. And I decided to, you know, find out who he was. I wanted to know who he was. I wanted to know his past. I wanted to know his positions, his policies. And so I just sort of dove right into it. I spent so much time researching him and watching videos of him, and just, I knew all about him. So I got to the point where I could just say, you know, if anyone asked me anything about Bernie, I could tell people, I could just flow and tell them, oh, he's for this, he's for that, he's for this. And I could point people to you know, videos of him and everything like that showed who he was. So I got actually a little consumed with the election. I went from not caring at all to just having it become my life. Bernie was all I was doing. In fact, I actually postponed I was supposed to take my, I'm in class right now, not right now, but I was in class and I'm starting to take my MCAT exam. And I said, I'm gonna postpone this because it happened to have, it was right around the time that we were supposed to have elections here in the state. And I said, well, I'm focusing way too much on the election and I'm not studying, so I just decided to postpone my exam until next year. So that's sort of showing you how far, you know, I went into this election. So, for me, he represented a kind of hope in people getting power again, taking back power from corporate our corporate rulers right now. And so I felt a lot of inspiration. And so I said, well, I started hearing about all the election fraud that was going on in other states. We heard about New York, we heard about Rhode Island, we heard about Arizona, it was a disaster, we heard Puerto Rico was a disaster. And so I said, I wanted to see for myself. I wanted to see if I could become a poll worker and I wanted to see these things for myself, and I said, well, I may not have much power, but if there's anything that I can do to make sure that things flow smoothly, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go in there, and I'm going to see, you know, read up both. Right now, we're seeing what little is left of our democracy being taken away. It may not seem like it's too much people because obviously most people pay attention to the mainstream media. Nobody talks about it, but it's happening. It's happening right now. It's happening in real time. And no one's getting upset. No one's saying anything. And that bothers me. It bothers me because we're going to have to grow up in this environment. And so do we really want to live in a system where our elections are dominated by corporate interests? Or we want to take back that control and give power to people, a true democracy. So that's what I think is another compelling reason for not only myself, but for every one of us to get involved at some level in our elections process. So that's me. So let me pass on.
Hello, everybody. My name is Kelsy. I have some fans here. So I was a poll worker. I was an inspector, which is the person in charge at a polling location where I'm from in Fremont. And you know, the main reason that I get involved, much like our comrade here, is that it is our civic duty to work a poll, much like people think of jury duty as our civic duty. We have to. I would strongly support, you know, making it mandatory for everyone to work the polls at some point. It would give a whole new appreciation for what we go through to have our right to vote. And not to toot my own horn, but I'm really good at it. I had an amazing experience as a poll inspector for the primary. I worked with a team of four other women who were incredible, and we did not have any problems with getting the correct ballot issued to people. We were very, concerned about making sure that everybody had their right to vote. We tried very hard to not just give out a bunch of provisional ballots because we didn't know. And I was very blessed that as far as the logistical part of voting went at my precinct, it went very well. However, there is a problem in this country that we are not addressing on any level at this point, I think, and that is voter education. The biggest problem that I had working at the polls was people would come in and they were registered improperly. They didn't understand how California's primary worked. Despite all of our get out the vote efforts and all the phone banking we did to people registered American Independent to make sure that they knew, you know, that's not your party, and everything that we did, there were still people who came in. And I have to say, it was actually a really interesting phenomenon. I had a lot of non-party voters come in who wanted to vote on the Republican primary ballot. Everybody was gonna, you know, take down Trump in California, and then they'd get there and realize, what do you mean I can't get a Republican ballot? And I thought about this a lot in the months after the primary election and just how insane it is when I think about the fact that we don't start engaging voters until they turn 18. But what we need to do in this country and our long-term goal, if we want to change this for the next generation and the generation after that, is that when you are born, you need to be going to the polls with your parents. You need to be, you know, having parents to involve their children when they fill out their vote by mail ballot. We need to start reaching out to our school boards and making sure that we have comprehensive civic education. I went to high school in Las Vegas. I was a senior in high school taking U.S. government during the Bush-Cherry election. I did not even learn how to caucus in a caucus state when I was 17 years old, a senior in government. So we have to do better about making sure that voter education, knowing how to vote, political scientists will tell you, voting is a habit, just like not voting is a habit. We need to make a habit out of voting from the moment that a child can walk into a polling location with their parents. And that is the only way that we will ever get the type of turnout that we want. So what my real solution and problem that I would like to address, that I would be putting my energy into, is really making sure that we're not forgetting our kids, because the sooner that we get them civically involved, basically the motto I'm going with is don't wait till they're 18. So my experience with polling and the problems that I think we have to address. Thank you.
So my name is Ricardo. I've had some similar experiences with Mario and Kelsy. I was a proud supporter of Bernie Sanders. I was one of the top phone bankers calling American independent voters, calling non-party preference voters, calling Democrats, calling Republicans, just trying our best to get Bernie Sanders the support that he needed in California. My polling experience was not as great as Kelsey's. My poll inspector kept handing the wrong ballots to the non-party preference voters, so I had to step in and give the right ballots to the right voters. There was a lot of voters that weren't on the voter rolls. There was a lot of millennials that weren't on the voter rolls. They had voted before, so they had no idea what was going on. They were registered as vote by mail, and they never got a ballot. So it was a very shocking experience for me because it was the first time that I worked the polls. I'm sort of more cynical about the election because it just felt like it was a huge waste of time. So many hours calling voters, so many hours doing door-to-door. So many hours talking to all my friends about Bernie just seemed like it went down the drench because the election process just seemed really rigged and really unfair to Bernie Sanders supporters. So that was my election experience, and just really had some really similar experiences with Mario and Kelsy in terms of politics and really getting the word out.
My name is Richard Tamm. I got involved after the 2004 election because it was so obvious that it had been stolen in so many ways. I researched that tremendously. There was a great teaching in early 2005, and that's when the Voting Rights Task Force started. I don't know if you were there at that one, Bob. I think you were. A lot of people, we filled this huge church in Oakland with hundreds and hundreds of people. And that's how I got involved with this little group called the Voting Rights Task Force, which is working with the Bernie group to sponsor this and have an ongoing thing. So we've been involved, like I said, the Voting Rights Task Force for many years. I've worked any number of elections already. The last two or three, I've been what they call the inspector. They have these funny names. You know, if you're running a polling place, you're called the inspector. And if you assist the lead, you're called the judge. You know, they're funny names. Anyway, the nice thing about being the inspector is that you have control over everything. So you can make sure everybody who goes there to vote gets the right information and that they will vote, if at all possible, on a real ballot, and it will go into the scanner. And one little extra thing you could do, since if you're the inspector or the judge and the other doesn't object, you can print off an extra copy of the poll tape at the end of the day and take it home with you. So you can have your own evidence if you need it. You know, it's kind of a handy thing to have. You know, it's not something you do for the money working at the polls. This is the 160-page manual for the inspectors and judges for this last primary election. You're not doing it for the money. You're doing it because you believe in, you know, the civic responsibility. To me, you know, voting is like the one most sacred thing you could do in a republic to maintain the republic and to maintain our freedoms. It's the ability to vote and to know the election is clean and honest and as far as you can make it. And so it's the one thing we all should strive to do to help out. And one thing I was thinking, you know, we have a lot of questions about whether the voting machines are counting the votes correctly. One thought I had is, you know, working the polls, you have a 14-hour day. You're there from 6 in the morning till about 10 o'clock at night. From 6 to 8, you're doing a mad scramble trying to get everything set up so that, no, 6 to 7, because the polls open at 7. You're doing a mad scramble trying to get everything set up properly so that the polls can open at 7 and everything will be running correctly. You close at 8, and then there's the mad scramble to put everything back together and bring everything to a collection center. Now, at this collection center, you get there with one other person, with all the ballots, the memory cards, and the other things they consider most important that they pick up that night. The people in the polling places get there at various times. Some people get there really fast. Some polling places, it takes a lot longer time. One thought I had is, I haven't seen it written anywhere that it would be illegal to do. When you close a polling place and open the scanner, get all the material finally back into the box and deliver it to the central receiving area just a little bit later. That would be one way to do a hand count in a polling place and verify if these numbers are correct. And I don't think it's in the law anywhere saying you can't do that. All it says is you have to, you know, all the regulations say you have to put the ballots in a box and seal it and bring that back to the collection center with all the other material. That's one thing that but you would need to get the agreement of the other people working at that poll. So my suggestion is, if you want to work the polls, if you could get a number of people to work at the same polling place, bring in a couple of friends as observers, because they could observe either before you open, during the day, or after you close, as long as they don't interfere. They could come in after 8 with video recording equipment to prove that you're not messing around with any of the ballots, that you're just separating them and doing a quick count. That way, you can't be accused of messing around with the ballots because you have it all recorded. It's just a thought.
So, I didn't really discuss any of my actual experiences. So I guess I'll discuss that now, and if anyone wants to go into even more detail than they already did, I can probably do that. So on the day of the election, as we said, we arrived around social speeder by 6 a.m. in order to set everything up and open by 7. So I arrived super early thinking, you know, I mean, we have a lot of stuff to set up, let's get everything ready by the time, you know, people start rolling in. So I arrived before 6, and I was the first one to arrive. I sat there, I found the actual polling location, and I was the first one to arrive. I stood there for like at least half an hour, just waiting for somebody to show up. And finally, the inspector showed up, and she was the only one. So it was just me and the inspector. We were setting everything up, and it was already after 6:30. So we had less than half an hour to set everything up. So we had machines to roll out, we had boxes starting pack, we had the tables to set up. We've got 2 tables. We had a table like this where we had the voter rolls, and then we had another table on the side where we had the actual ballots. So my job was to, as people were coming in, they would come to our table, I would find their name on the rolls. If they were on the rolls, I would give them a ballot for the party that they're registered with. So let's say so-and-so person is registered Democrat, so I would give them a Democratic little ticket with a certain number on it. They take this ticket to the next table, and there they get the actual ballot. One of the problems that we encountered, or as we all know, people that were not on the rolls that have been but are for some reason not this time, people whose location has been changed, even though they've been voting at this location for years, people who have had their parties switched somehow, people who have been lifelong Democrats that are now all of a sudden Republicans or American Independent Party. What else? If you can think about it, we had that problem at least once. So you would think that, you know, with an election this important, that things would be able to flow smoothly. And it was not that case. Another thing that we had this cycle that I'm not sure, again, because I haven't been involved, that we had in the past were for provisional ballots. For provisional ballots, we would have a special circumstance. We would have a standard ballot, but we put a little pink dot on the barcode on the side so that when you, if you try to enter it into the machine would reject it because it wouldn't be able to read the barcode. So one of the things that I noticed was that people, that my fellow co-workers, didn't really know what the pink dot was for. So in the beginning, when we were first getting the first few ballots and the first few people that came in, people would fill out the ballots, but the machine wasn't accepting the ballot. They didn't have anything on it, it was just a standard ballot, but the machine wasn't reading the ballot, it was rejecting it. So they tried to repeatedly put it back in, and the machine wasn't taking it. So their solution was to take the ballot, put a pink dot on it, and then put it in the bag next to it, where we would have all the standard provisional ballots. So these are people's ballots, people who are actually on the rolls, registered voters, who filled out the ballot, but was probably counted as a provisional ballot because the machine wasn't accepting it. So eventually they restarted the machine. Now it was accepting the ballots, but still, even though the people who were in charge of the ballots on the table next to us, were still putting pink dots on all the ballots. And I looked over and I was like, wait, that's not, I told them, you know guys, that's those pink dots are only for provisional ballots. And they're like, okay.
What county is this?
Sorry?
What county is this?
This is county, ContraCostaCounty, yeah. I was over at the 960 Triangle Court, over in the Iron Triangle, the area of Richmond. So they kept doing that. And I turned around the second time and I told them, you guys, those are only for provisional ballots. You can't be putting those pink dots on all the ballots. So it looks like that time they got the message and they stopped putting all the ballots. But I mean, we probably had at least half a dozen people who came in and voted and whose votes were probably counted as provisional ballots because they put those pink dots on them. So our problems afterwards, kept going, you know, same old problems where people came in and they couldn't find them. We had the voter rolls were divided into two. People who were from A to N, I think it was, and then from N to C. So we had those lists there. We had a supplemental list of vote by mail ballots. We had another list at the back of the standard rolls. And then we had, was it something, I think there was a blue list of newly registered voters that some people got. We didn't get, but I had heard some other precincts throughout California get. So there was that. We didn't have that. So the whole day, it was just, it seemed like people were really confused. They didn't know what was going on. They didn't know what party they were registered for. And so this kind of just brings to light how complicated our election system is. Why is it this complicated? Why is it not easier? For such a fundamental right for people to have. Why is it so complicated?
I just want to say one more thing. I do poll, I work the polls in Alameda County, and he was in Contra Costa County. Alameda County, there was some of the people who did the training got very unclear information about what to do with no party preference voters, which were mainly Bernie voters. Since I had worked the polls a number of times in Alameda County, I knew who the registrar was and the deputy registrar, and I started badgering them to make sure they're trained well with what to do with no party preference voters, to offer them the choices of these, you could get a crossover ballot, Democrat, American Independent, or another party. I kept having to badger them over and over because they claimed that they did teach it okay. They kept insisting on that. I kept badgering them. Finally, the weekend before the primary, they put out an email to all the people working the polls to watch the video about how to handle no party preference voters, which I thought was correct. So I was happy they did that. But I think because I badgered them, I have tried twice to volunteer to be a poll worker in this next election, and I have never heard back from them. So I think I'm on a blacklist with them now. But that's okay. That's okay. I could take a break and do other things.
All right, that will be wrapping it up. Let's give our poll workers a hand. And hopefully we'll have time for questions later. The next speaker, most of what I know about how politics has gone wrong is really from the registrars or the Board of Election directors. Most of what the problems with the system in Ohio, where I work, all has come from very straightforward registrars who are well aware of the problem. So we're very blessed for analysis of the system from Joe Canciamilla, the ContraCostaCounty Registrar, who will be explaining the problems with these incredible complexities and what can be done. So thank you very much.
And thank you all for coming out for this presentation. Let me talk a little bit about the physical operation of what goes on, and then I'll talk a bit about some of the specific issues this last time, what we're doing for this November, and then be happy to answer any questions. We have a staff of roughly 45 permanent employees that work in elections year-round. When we're not in election preparation mode, they're doing the GPS analysis that we're redesigning and re-examining precinct locations. We're dealing with accessibility issues. We're processing voter registrations, and we're dealing with the equipment and preparing for the next election cycles. We maintain a battery of about 400 machines for each purpose. So we have auto marks that are the electronic marking devices for accessibility purposes. Those have to be maintained and tested before each election. We have the same thing with the scanning machines that have to be maintained and tested. So we have folks that are trained in-house to be able to do that. When I came in, one of the things we did was renegotiate our contracts with ES&S so that we didn't have to rely on their coming in to maintain our equipment. We were able to do it on our own, and we're able to test those independently of having an outside contractor come in. The other thing you discover is that most counties get charged ridiculous amounts of money to have these folks come in and do this work. It's incredibly expensive to have them come in and frankly deal with what is very outdated technology. The other thing that we have started doing is we've changed the way we deal with poll workers. And you just heard from a group of poll workers. The reality is that we rely on volunteers. Poll workers are volunteers. They work maybe once every couple of years. They work in very trying circumstances, very long days. And in a primary election, which is the most complex, they're dealing with rules that we don't necessarily always make. The parties decide their rules for their primaries. So in this case, we have to take a group of, and we use about 1,800 people. We have to recruit. I brought some cards in case anyone is interested in serving as a poll worker. We're still looking for poll workers. But we go through a training for poll workers. We've started a separate training program for inspectors. And we have a third set of training for rovers. And rovers are people that are assigned to basically troubleshoot among a variety of polling locations. We have over 600 precincts divided into 278 polling locations around the county. So we rely on the poll workers to be able to manage those locations. And one of the things that I've found is that while we can teach the technical part of it, and we can provide the manuals and provide the direction, one of the things that we've started to try and focus more on is teaching some leadership skills to our inspectors. so that they feel that they are in fact in charge of that polling location. They can take control, and they can direct how the clerks will handle some of the issues that arise. But frankly, when you're dealing with folks who are working once every couple of years, they have varying degrees of interest in elections, they have varying degrees of abilities, they have varying degrees of commitment to the process. So we try and find, for lack of a better phrase, the best and brightest that are willing to work as inspectors. But on election day, we'll have a certain number of people that will either cancel out at the last minute, they'll get sick, the car breaks down, something happens, and we've got to replace them at the last minute. So operationally, not every precinct is going to run as smoothly as we would like. That's where the rovers come in, and that's where the other piece of what we've tried to do comes in, which is to establish a command center in our office so that when there are issues that arrive at a polling place, the poll workers have a dedicated number that they can call to get answers, as opposed to trying to figure out how to trouble through and power through some of these issues. They can call. We also try and encourage them to participate in a hands-on equipment training where we actually have them touch the machines before an election and we simulate a whole bunch of problems. So what happens if it jams? What happens if it doesn't read a ballot? What happens if the light doesn't go on? What happens if the ballot's going the wrong way? So as much as we try and deal with all of these what-ifs, there will always be something that will happen that day that will create some problems. And we try and encourage them to contact our office to get those issues resolved. But despite all of that, and despite all the efforts, there will still be things that go wrong. What we try and do is minimize the number of things that can go wrong, and we try and minimize the challenges that our poll workers face, because we don't want them to be in an awkward situation. We don't want to put them in a difficult position with dealing with voters. We try very hard to get it right, and we try very hard to ensure that the process is extremely transparent. So we encourage people, if you have questions, if you have issues, and we did this last time, come in and observe the process. You can observe the testing of the equipment. You can observe how the ballots are handled when they come into our office. You can observe at the polling places. You can observe as we're processing provisional ballots. You can observe as we process vote-by-mail ballots. We start, in this case, we'll start on October 29th with a large-scale ballot opening. So we'll begin to open the vote-by-mail ballots we get in so that we can process them ahead of the election and get them ready to start counting so that we can provide a pretty accurate count right when the polls close on election night. But it's a very physical process because you're dealing with, in our case, a three-card ballot. We're going to have over 1 million pieces of paper that have to be handled. So by starting early, we're hoping we can eliminate a lot of the drags and the problems that we might have otherwise when you try and jam through the process on election day. Election day, we don't cross any, we try not to process any ballots. We want to focus entirely on election day services and dealing with issues at the polling places. So as much as we can get done in advance, that's what we try and do. And we encourage people to come in, to watch the process, to volunteer and help us with that process. We're going to need hundreds of people to help extract ballots. We're going to need people to help with all of that processing, and we look forward to getting as many people as we can involved. One of the conversations that some of the poll workers talking about was voter education. And when I came into this position, one of the things that I did was go to our board of supervisors and say, we need some help with community participation in voter education. We have a pilot program with two people dedicated to voter education and community outreach, because in Contra Costa's case, we're really in a media black hole. We have very little local press coverage anymore. We have a shrinking number of reporters. We have a shrinking number of newspapers. We have almost no TV or radio coverage for our local issues. So trying to engage voters, trying to get them educated, trying to get them to understand what's happening in local communities and with all of these issues is extremely difficult. And as we try and reach out to voters and we try and get people registered and we try to teach them about how important it is to vote and participate in the process, if they're not seeing a relationship between what they're asked to do and a value it provides to the local community, they're just not going to care. And for those of us that are sort of geeky about it and political nerds and we watch all this stuff and we care about it and we follow it, yeah, it's a big deal. But for most people, they're getting burned out, they're getting tired. And the national stuff is frankly, from what I can see, driving people away as opposed to bringing them in. So we need to be able to figure out a way to engage them on local issues. And that's what we're trying to do now, is figure out how we get that messaging in. So for this election, in particular, we're reaching out to high schools and the junior colleges and community colleges. We had a training at Concord High School a week ago. We had over 140 students participate in the training to be poll workers on election day. We're doing the same thing. We're trying to do the same thing. We'll be having a training here in Richmond. We're going to be doing a training in my home community of Pittsburgh, and we're going to be doing a training later this week there. We have over 100 students that are signed up to be poll workers, and over, I last count, 300 students that are going to be helping us over a two-day period to do the ballot extraction. So we're trying to get them involved and engaged, because without that involvement and that engagement and that basic education, they're not going to participate. And at the same time, we're trying as well to get them to push their parents a bit, because the places that need the participation the most, here in West County, out my way in East County, we have the worst voter turnouts. Mm-hmm. It's 15-20% here, it's 25% where I am. You know, La Mirinda, San Ramon Valley, it gets 70-80-90% engagement and involvement. But the communities that need it most have it the least. And so we're trying to pump resources into West and East County to engage the schools, to provide not only the outreach, but to give them lesson plans and to give them basically registration kits and voter education kits, so that the teachers really don't have to reinvent the wheel each time. They can take our voter registration kit, they can open it up, and there's information on the entire voting process, what it takes, what's involved, and it gives them places to go, like the League of Women Voters and other locations, to get information on some of the local races. So we're trying to do that, but it's extremely challenging in an area like ours, where to get that messaging out is, it's just a challenge. We don't have the paper, we don't have the news media, so we're trying to figure out, can we use social media? We're trying to figure out, can we use the schools, but they're burdened with all the things they've got going on. So we're trying to also tap into all the little local groups that are out there, the patches, the local papers, the local online papers, at least the ones that aren't too slanted one way or another. But trying to at least develop some partnerships so that we can start to develop more and more of the messaging. And that helps us, because the more educated people are about the process, then the more educated they are about voting in general. Yes. The governor signed SB 450, which is a, let's see, how do I describe 450? Let me add just a disclaimer first. I was one of like two or three registrars in the state that openly opposed the bill, so. I have a bit of a bias, but what it would do is it would allow certain counties initially in 2018 and some more in 2020 to go to a vote by mail ballot, but at the same time it would require the establishment of a large number of vote centers and drop-off locations for ballots. So it basically is what we have now, only with more rules. And I think part of the confusion we have is we haven't picked a system. If we went with a Colorado vote center model, it would be one thing. If we went with an Oregon, Washington, all mail-in ballot model, it would be another thing. But this is sort of a hybrid.
We haven't picked a system.
We, the state. The state of California hasn't picked a system. So SB 450, I think, has a lot of problems associated with it. It's neither fish nor fowl, and I think in looking at the requirements in the bill, there are going to be very few counties that are going to be able or willing to participate with it, and that at the when it's all said and done, it's going to be a much more expensive and much more confusing process for the voters, because every voter would get a vote by mail ballot, but then you'd still have the ability to go to the vote center, you'd still have the ability to go to basically a polling place. So it's you're going to just have hundreds and thousands and millions of ballots floating out there. It's not a good design in my opinion.
It looks like you're almost out of time. Are there any really important points you still want to make?
I think that for November there'll be fewer problems because it's a less complex election. We are trying to take some of the lessons we learned from the primary and apply them to November. So we are changing our rosters to make it easier for poll workers to find names. We're doing, instead of having one set of checks at the polling station, we're gonna have a second set. So if we can't find your name in the roster, the poll worker is having a problem, you're gonna go to a second spot, and they will double check another roster just to ensure that your name hasn't been missed, that you're registered at the correct location. The other thing we're doing is we're expanding our early voting model. We offered early voting this last time as an option in stations around the county. We're expanding that. We're expanding the number of drop-off locations for people to be able to leave their ballots. So we'll be at city halls, we'll be at a number of libraries and community centers so that folks can drop their ballots off early. We prefer that you let us know if you want to observe at a particular location so we can give the poll workers a heads up. But the only requirement is that you just not interfere with the voting process. But there's no training required.
I think there's about three or four more questions. We'll take all of those, and then we have one more speaker before lunch. So in the back.
There's an exception for students, yeah, and there's an exception for a few other categories. So no, they don't have to necessarily be registered voters.
The second part is the registration kit sounds like a fabulous idea to me. Who pays for that?
We do.
Who's we?
Our county. My department, my office.
So the county has to decide.
Yes. We have a very strange system in California. We have some rules are sent to us by the state, and other rules are left to each county to do on their own. And yeah, it's a confusing system and makes it difficult for people who go from one county to another.
I was wondering if in the this SB 450 for voting by mail, I've heard some concerns about transparency and security and the counting vote, being able to observe it, being counted. Do you have any concerns that way?
And can you repeat the question?
The question was in 450 with all the mail-in ballots, that some folks have expressed a concern about the transparency of the process in counting the ballots. From my standpoint, we process vote by mail ballots a specific way. So they are open during a specific set of in a time frame, and then run through scanners in a particular time frame. So that process is visible throughout. So I wouldn't see it changing. If we were to go to a 450 model, I don't see that that would change.
Okay.
When you say you're looking for volunteers to work at the polls, does that mean that you're not paying them anything?
Well, we are, poll workers are paid, but they're considered technically volunteers. So you get a stipend as opposed to a salary or, but it is considered a volunteer.
Well, what is the pay for a typical poll worker?
$125, I think, okay, for the day. And then it's more for inspectors and more for voters.
Yes, hi. You know, my understanding is in states that have the mail-in, like Washington, I believe, they didn't have any problem. They didn't have any problem with election fraud or anything like that. There was no outcry. And they went 70% diverting, as a matter of fact. So I don't know. It seems to me maybe that system is a good system. Because in California, there were so many uncounted votes, maybe, or votes that got shredded, you know, in San Diego or other places, or just not counted. And I'm wondering, when do you count the mail-in ballots? Do you wait till the end, you know, or, because I don't even know if we count all the ballots yet.
Yeah, we do.
Can you repeat the question?
The question is, are all the ballots counted, and would mail-in be better?
Have California ballots all been counted?
Yes. Well, for ours have. Each county does their own processing, but we have to report to the state. But all the vote by mail ballots start getting processed in our case about a week before the election. So as the ballots are coming in, we process almost 178,000 before election day. So when the results were reported out a little after 8 on election night, those are all the vote by mail and all the drop-off ballots that came in up through that Saturday before the election. And then we continue processing afterwards. The last ballots that get processed are the provisionals, because we have to manually check each and every one. Over 90% of the provisionals that we got in were in fact counted. The vast majority of the ones that weren't counted were simply not counted because the individuals weren't registered.
Two more questions. Go ahead, John, and then you're the last.
My question would be, is what percentage in your county is vote by mail in precinct vote? As you like to see, you're a fairly large county with 10 million voters, and you have 700 precincts still?
Well, 678 precincts, 278 voting locations.
Big job. What percentage? And then another question that kind of goes with it. When you were 100% of your precincts, well, when the state became 100% on election night and said, hey, the people started doing the lottery thing. And it looked like to me, the survey of all 58 counties, that when you guys did the lottery, only 65% of the vote was included in the lottery, because you still had 35% of the vote that was in provisionals and vote by mail that were dropped off at the precincts. Was that true in your county? What percentage? What percentage of the lottery pick to do the random audit did you check? 65%, 60%,
75%? Gotcha. Let me start back from the beginning. So we anticipate by the November election we'll have about 600,000 registered voters in ContraCostaCounty. On Monday, we are sending 370-some-odd-thousand vote-by-mail ballots into the mail system. So roughly 60% or so of our voters are permanent vote-by-mail voters. We anticipate we're already receiving requests for vote-by-mail ballots. We expect that the vote-by-mail turnout this election will be around 70%. So 30% of the voters will be either poll voters, or they will drop their ballots off at the polling place or the voting location. There's been some litigation surrounding this whole question of dropping or the numbers that are taken for poll votes. We do the 1% random, and we pull that after election day. So we don't go with what you see on election day, because what's happening with the 100% reporting on election day is that that's just the election day reporting. So we wait until we get through the now with the vote by mail drop off plus three. We wait till we get to that point and then we do the 1%.
So a couple of days after.
Yeah, we're still not at 100% when that's done.
What do you think you're at? 90%?
Probably 90%. We're, the ones that aren't in that are the provisionals at that point. The provisionals and the last batch of unverified vote by mail. So it's probably 90%, maybe a little more. Kind of depends on the election.
Last question.
Just really quick, what recourse do citizens have of a county if their local county registrar, not you, I'm talking about my county,
from just being general observers?
General observers following the rules.
The remedy, if the registrar won't pay any attention, is to go to the Board of Supervisors. Even though I'm elected, the Board of Supervisors is responsible for my budget. So while they can't necessarily tell me operationally what to do, they control the purse strings, so they have a certain amount of influence. If the registrar is appointed, then clearly the Board of Supervisors could provide that direction. The other place to go would be the Secretary of State's office, because they do issue rules and guidelines on observers and poll workers. There's a certain amount of flexibility, but the rules are still there.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Joe. And good information and good rates of counting provisionals. I was in Cleveland in 2004. Michael Vu worked there then. 41% of the provisionals were not counted. Next we have Karin Accorinti, the Deputy Director.
I'm actually from SantaClaraCounty. I'm not the Deputy Director. I'm the manager for polling places, so I'm in charge of recruiting all the election officers for election day. We do the training for the election officers, we recruit the polling places, and we do voter education. So we have a lot of similarities with Contra Costa. For Santa Clara County, this election, we're going to have 837 polling locations. We have a little bit more than 800,000 registered voters. And we have to recruit election officers that speak 9 different languages. So the requirements are a little bit different. We recruiting election officers all year round. We never stop in order for us to have all the people that we need for this election. Probably around 4,000 election workers. We have to have a database of over 20,000 election officers. So we contact all the election officers in our database, people who have volunteered with us over the years, to see if they're interested in helping us. Based on that, we get all the people that we need. We still need at this point around 2,000 people to help us for the November election. We do have a very successful high school program. We work with all the high schools in Santa Clara. In the last presidential election, we had around 400 kids helping us. Our high school cannot run, high school students cannot run the polling place. You know, they're great. They usually learn very fast. They learn how to use the machine very fast, but we still need adults to run the polling place. We can have them as a clerk, of course. They cannot work as an inspector. It is a challenge every election. I've been working on elections for 15 years. And every election is getting harder and harder to have people that want to volunteer. Some of them, they think that we don't pay enough. Other things, that the hours are too long, and other people really, you know, don't care. They don't see the value. People ask why we don't have all vote by mail and we don't have polling places. You have other people say, oh, we shouldn't have vote by mail at all. You don't have enough polling places. So we're in the middle trying to make this system work. We have been very fortunate. Every election, we do get the number of volunteers. We have around 20% of our volunteers do not show up on our ID to participate. We organize the election, but this is not our election. You know what I mean? It's for all of us. We're doing all of this for the community. And in order for us in the United States to run this election, in California to run an election, we cannot do it without the volunteers. We have training classes. We have our volunteers have to go to 3.5 hours of training, and we also offer online training. We do hands-on. All of our inspectors are required to go to a training class, otherwise they cannot work. And what we have implemented this election is that they have to pass a little test. So after the class, we give them a test. If we see that they score lower than 70%, we send them to a second class. Or we talk to them and we invite them to come to our office to see if they need more help. But as Joe was saying, the majority of our volunteers, they work, we have people that they only want to work during presidential election. It's a lot of information. How many of you are poll workers? Great. It's a lot of information to remember in one day. We that do this all the time, and we deal with these laws and all the procedures, and we get together and try to see how can we make closing easier for our poll workers. How are they going to remember these 250 forms that they have to complete on election day? Let's color code it. Okay, pink, blue, yellow. And we try to teach all of them all this information in one day and 3 hours. There's things that they're going to forget. You know, there's the attention span is an hour maybe. So we try to concentrate on things that are really important. We also have a center on election day for them to call us if they have any problems. And we do have robots. We call them field inspectors that are in charge of between 6 precincts. So we have a person every 6 precincts to go out and help with any problems. We arrive at their office, and you're all welcome to come and observe what we do at 5 a.m. in the morning on election day. By 5:30, 5:45, it's the phones are ringing nonstop. You know, when people have questions, people didn't show up. Things happen. The polling place, the janitor was going to open the polling place, did not show up. How do we do that now? Or my favorite, we always have every election is an inspector going to the polling place and they got into an accident. So. Now what? You know, who's going to open the place? Who has the ballots? It's very exciting. I see election day. It's really exciting. You know, I see election day like an opening night. You know, you do all this preparation work for months, and then you never know exactly how things are going to go. And you have all these locations, so it's not just one central location. 837 locations. But you're hoping that everybody is going to show up, and we're hoping that the voters are going to show up to work. Let me tell you, we're so disappointed after all this work when the turnout is only like 20%. We're like, really? So we rely on the community. We have partnered with different organizations in the community. We recently started a partnership with the Office of Education for Santa Clara County. So we're changing, we have been working with them trying to change the civic curriculum for the kids, trying to start talking to them about participation since they're in kindergarten. So yeah, we'll see in 10 years. See, you know, as they get older, we have been developing all summer different activities and curriculums with teachers for them to start working and doing little things from kindergarten all the way to high school. We do the voters kit that we send, the voter registration kits that we send to every high school. We pay for that also, the county pays for that. The kids love it. They like to be empowered, to be able to set up the table, to register voters, to return information to our county. So that's a really good activity for high school kids. Now, the successful for a high school program, in my opinion, is to be able to find the right teacher at the high school who's going to help you to carry this. Because usually when you just call the principal or the secretary, it doesn't happen. So when you have, it takes a long time to create a relationship with one teacher that wants to do this, that wants to help you coordinate the high school volunteers, or they help you coordinate the voter registration drive at the school. As I said, we have been working on this for over 15 years, and there are certain areas in the county that the participation is great. In other areas, they're really, they keep some, you know, they don't want to get involved. Our county actually was one of the supporters for SB 450. So we are gonna, we're looking and trying to implement that for 2018. We see it as an advantage for the voters to be able to have voting centers. It doesn't matter where you live. You're gonna be able to go to one of these locations in the county. I think that we're thinking about 100 locations for SantaClaraCounty. We don't have the set number, but a minimum of 100 locations. And you go and you vote. So it doesn't matter if you are in San Jose, but you work in Palo Alto. You can go to any location within the county and vote. So that will take us, we're working on that, see how to try to start that in 2018. So that's all I have. Yeah.
People to use the mic so we can, since it's being live streamed.
The processing of the ballots and how are they selected?
So we have permanent staff at the office, probably around 50 people. We recruit temporary personnel, staff that work with us. They usually start 6 months before the election. For our county, they have to be part of the, they come through the HR list, people who apply for extra health positions in the county. We interview them and we hire them to work in the elections. If they have volunteers that help with counting the ballots on election night, people who, you know, they want to volunteer, we interview them, and if we think they're a good fit, they work with us.
How often does an opening come up?
For a volunteer on election night?
It's one of the 50 permanent staff who processes ballots.
It's not just one of the 50. We have probably on election night around 200 people voting, helping in the office. Not all of them are going to be counting ballots. There's a lot of things that happen on election night. We do have volunteers that just volunteer for one night to count the ballots. And the other permanent positions that we have in the office, well, you have to wait until someone retires and go to the other.
I wonder if Joe could come up and we could get a contrast between the two. Counties, if you're willing to come up. I had one question that the technical people that come in, this is a huge problem in Ohio, people come into your polls with these little badges from ES&S and other companies and seem to have tremendous control over the machines. Is that a problem?
We don't have anybody from the company coming.
We don't either. I've never seen anyone. I've seen them come to observe the testing process, but I've never seen any of them come on election day.
We did have when we implemented the machines, the first election support, you know, this was like 12 years ago, support from the company because we were implementing this new equipment and wanted to make sure that everything worked fine.
And Mario will give you a mic, people with their hands up.
During election night counting, do you have just random observers watching you count?
Yes.
And how do they become an observer?
They just show up on election night.
Come in and say, I'm
going to watch. And they give them, you know, a set of rules that they have to stay in a certain area or walk with someone from the office. We don't want people, you know, walking in the office randomly, so and they can see our processes are open to the public.
So it's not random.
Yes,
okay.
We do. A lot of our volunteer, a lot of our observers, they let us know ahead of time. Some groups bring a large number of people, so they want to know that we have space. Our office is not too big, so that will be the only problem sometimes, that you know you have a lot of people and you don't have enough space.
In our case, there's not a lot to see on election night because we're not counting ballots on election night. We're processing just the memory cards that come in from the scanners at the polling location. So we don't start processing ballots again until the day after the election.
If I can,
right? Yep, we had observers the entire time this past election cycle.
Let me follow up. Observers inside the precincts. In Ohio, they have to be registered to a party in 10 days in advance. Is that applicable here?
No.
I mean, someone could actually go
sure.
in?
Yes. Mm-hmm. As long as they don't interfere with the process, they can observe the process.
Yeah. How do you want
to? Let's see. I'm an attorney, and I was working with the senator's legal team, and one of the things we were seeing all over the country how voters' registration was getting switched and different things were happening. And once they got us attorneys together, they were very distant, so we didn't have communication with the actual Sanders team. I don't want to put out like I was like this with them. We were kind of a satellite thing, but they did pull us together, and we were doing what we could. And one of the projects I was on was trying to through social media, find out how many people's voter registration was getting switched, and it was without their consent. It was an amazing number of people. And I came up with the idea, if I could get people to vote early before registration deadline, then at the registrar's office they could fix those problems. If they went in and saw that for some reason they were registered as a Republican, right there with a professional registrar people, they could get that fixed. So I really, really pushed hard for that, and I got some feedback from social media of problems they were having. And one was a person that said she called Sonoma County and wanted to vote early, and they told her they didn't have early voting in Sonoma County. And so I called the registrar there, and she said, well, they used a different terminology for it. And I was like, well, could you educate your phone workers so they know if somebody calls in and wants to vote early, you know, that they're on the same page and they're not turning people away and thinking that's not an option. I got calls about Contra Costa in that there was some sort of publicity thing about when your satellites were opening and that had early voting. And it was giving people the impression that early voting didn't start until the day your satellites opened. And so they were, and I was saying, well, I'm sure they do, you probably have to go to the registrar's office, but I'm sure you still could do it. But that was misleading and confusing. And just the number of people that had their voter registration changed without their permission just was mind-boggling. And then recently I saw, and I think it was through one of the leaks, that, and I don't think it was, I don't know that this is secret information, but it was something I don't think people were aware of. The DNC actually has the ability to go into the election records and change voter registration. It's like there for it's there for purposes of functioning and doing the work. It's not supposed to be abused, but it's a capability that the leaks found in their systems.
It's not in California. The voter registration databases up until recently, which we're now shifting over to VoteCal, which is a state database, all the databases are maintained by the counties. So there's no outside access to those by the DNC or the RNC or anyone else. And I don't doubt that in some cases there might be glitches where somebody's registration gets changed, but we got inundated with online voter registrations, and so I actually sat at the computer for like 3 days and helped process voter registrations, and people would call me and ask, okay, how did I get switched? I was never. And I literally pull up their handwritten voter registration cards, and they registered that way. Or a spouse registered them, or somebody did something, but, you know.
The registrar of Santa Clara County was interviewed by one of our attorneys with the media, and her daughter, who I think worked in the department, came up to her and said, Mom, my registration's been flipped. And a lot of these were people that were, you know, like us, older people, most of us, and for decades have been registered in the party at the same address, have not re-registered in any reason, have always voted. And
I don't doubt that happened in some cases. I'm not sure that it was always.
I have one more question. In your two counties, I have gotten reports that there was a big difference in the exit polls, and I wondered if you had any idea how that happened.
We don't do exit polls, so I have no clue. I would have no way of knowing what that was.
Okay, got a question for both of you. One, who programs your database? Do you do it yourself? You know, because the database builds the ballot. You subcontract that out and have a program, or do you have somebody in each of your offices, your IT department handle that? And then with your vote by mail, who verifies the signature? Is it done by a Pitney bowl or a machine, or is it done by eye?
In our county, when you say build the database, build the ballot design, or?
Well, the database is, when you get the database that you use to count the votes, like for example, in GEMS or a lot of these systems, you build it, and then the ballot is generated from that, and.
We have bubble ballot, so it's a Scantron, and it's done by our local folks in house. Set the timing chain on the side of the ballots, and the coding for the readers. So it's all done in-house.
Scantron, what system is, I thought you were EFNS.
We are, but it's just a Scantron. It's just a reading the dots on the ballots as they go through the machines.
Is there any digital imagery involved? Is the system you're using, or is it the old system?
It's the old system.
So you're using the M650?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, we have 650.
Yeah. And then you got M100s?
Yes.
And what are you using for your handicap?
Automarks.
Okay, good system.
And then the other part of your question was, I'm sorry.
Well, who programs your database?
Yes, that's in-house.
And then the signatures, how do you verify the signatures on your vote by name?
That's all done. We have a four-step process. So they go through, they get scanned, and they get sent to live people. And they go through four. If they're bounced at level one, they go to a supervisor. If the supervisor bounces it, it goes to a manager. And ultimately, it goes to the assistant registrar, who makes the final determination. So there are four sets of eyes that look at them. And the vast majority, in our case, it's almost 97%, I believe, in this last election, all ended up being verified through the process. And if it looks like a signature has been, if somebody is aging or there's a problem with reading it, we will actually contact the voter just to double check.
Same. We as ISD and in-house go through the machine, and it's the same process for vote by mail.
We have a mic up here with Lori.
I wanted to ask you, actually I was involved in a citizen exit poll in both of your counties, but to Crespo, but what I observed are the people who were doing the exit poll in Santa Clara could not find any poll tapes on the doors at the end of election night, and also said that there were not scanners and the votes were collected into canvas bags.
We do not have scanners in Santa Clara County.
Okay, so there wasn't any way that with a tape that you could understand how the precinct voted.
The only thing that you're gonna see outside the polling place in Santa Clara County is if the person used the DRA machine. We have both. We have the machine, the DRA machine, the one that votes electronically, but we have paper ballots.
Uh-huh. So the votes that are put into a canvas bag are then taken where? And
to our office for Central County. So we have the vote, all the votes, the paper ballots come back to our office and we process them in the office.
And the kind of scanner that you use is by which company?
Sequoia.
Sequoia?
Mm-hmm.
Huh. Not SOE. Huh. Interesting. Okay, thanks.
There's a couple more questions if we can move the mic over there.
I'll make one suggestion. If there are problems with voter registrations where people are claiming their registration to change and they never changed it themselves, one way to deal with it might be to have a backup copy from like 6 months ago and from a year ago, because if somebody is hacking it and it's just before the election, you could go back to the older version and say, yes, you were registered this way. Just a thought.
And we actually can do that, and we did in a number of cases, because in the state database, you could actually pull up the voter registration card that the person filled out, or you could pull up the information that they've gone through the DMV. So we can actually see all of the various stops along the way.
Thank you both for your participation today. I'm a poll worker in a foreign country. I live in Berlin. And I have a registrar of voters who is on record at believing that Marin County's electoral system cannot be hacked by an outside computer. What would you do in that case to, not that I have a desperate need to intellectually prove that she doesn't know what she's talking about, but what would you do as the next step? Because it's pretty easy to drive by the Marin Civic Center and he can do some extraordinary things with a portable mat.
I don't honestly know what system they use.
Dipole gems.
Did they use dipole? In our county, we're not connected to anything, so there's no way somebody could hack because there's nothing to hack into. There's no internet connection, there's no Wi-Fi, there's no computer connection. You'd have to actually intervene either in the process of programming the equipment, which would have to be somebody in-house. It would be a very complex issue. There's no access from the outside. Now, I don't know if Marin is different. I think Santa Clara is probably the same as we are.
Hi, I wonder if you could just clarify for us quickly the differences between the official observer panel letter invitation that gets sent out by the registrar voters and just the average person on the street who wants to walk in and observe and monitor, if that makes any sense. I've seen letters of invitation that have gone out to like the Democratic Central Committee in various counties that have certain steps that the observers need to go through, which is different from me, who has gone in and observed on a regular basis without even having to get invited. They get me whether they want me or not.
We've never had, in my experience, I've lived in it 3 years, but in my experience, we've not had an official observer panel. We've had groups come in, but we don't have guidelines or rules for qualifying as a panel.
The same for our county. What we do have is some organizations that they know that they're going to be observing. They contact our office and said, would you mind giving us a letter that says that we are observers, so in case that they have any questions from the election officers who are very protective about what's happening on the polls on election day, they can present the letter, you know, so they know it's okay for them to observe.
Yes. A letter has come out to the Fresno County Central Committee and presumably to the other parties as well, that if you want to be an election observer, you must let the registrar of voters know by October 12th, and each observer must participate in three separate sessions of training, each 2 hours in length, two of them on weekday mornings where people who work must take the training. If not, then they will not be allowed to be election observers in Fresno County. This, we think, has come about because the team sitting here with me were all observers at the primary vote, and the registrar told us specifically that this is the first time they've ever had an election observer observing what they've been doing. So now they're making it almost impossible for people to observe.
Oh, and?
And this particular registrar has already done the alleged random selection for the 1% manual tally. They did that the 30th of August, even though we protested that they should not do that this time.
For the November election.
For the November election, yes. They've selected the precincts for the random, for the manual, 1% manual tally.
Right.
Okay, a few more questions. I think we got four more, and then we'll wrap up here. They've been very indulgent.
Yes, so I transferred, or 2 years ago, relocated from Orange County to Marin. A glitch with the transfer in the mail, that's our post office. The interesting thing, and I this might shed some light on the party flipping, is the way the new registration to transfer from Orange to Marin, the way it was laid out, is over to the right was a very, very small and smaller font, and you had to check a box for your party. Everything else was pretty straightforward. You were going down the sheet. So I missed that, so I was put in as declined to state, or now they call it an NP. Although I had been a registered Democrat in Orange County, and where I would put Democrat, 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 that wasn't the registering. They ignored all of this, and they were only looking at that little box. And I think probably a lot of people missed that little box because it was out of the line of sight. So that, I think how things are laid out when you're registering is important. I wanted to just commend you on getting the children involved. When I was in Orange County and my son was in high school, one of the ways that I got him involved was through a good teacher. And what I did with her, and the register agreed to it, was we split the day, so my son and I, and we got some of the other parents. So we got some of the kids involved, but we also got parents who wouldn't normally be involved in the process, got involved because their kids were excited. So, because sometimes it's, that 12-hour day is really hard, and a lot of your poll workers are older, so that 14-hour day is grueling. If they can split it with a high school kid, you know, the kid gets the credit for the community outreach, which is really important, and somebody that maybe would walk away or not be able to do a full day gets involved.
Okay, I think there's four more questions.
Can we take one question from the live stream?
Sure.
David Smith asks, what are the thoughts by the speakers on the plan to take over elections by the DHS, or the Department of Homeland Security?
I'm not aware of any of that.
It wasn't included in the critical infrastructure, and then the Russian access came out, so there's a move to move it in part of the critical infrastructure. It appeared to be an oversight, and now all the major newspapers, including the New York Times, have said, yes, it's happened.
There was a call yesterday through DHS. There was a conference call that talked about security issues, but it was at a very high level of conversation and very general, and frankly, I think the feds would have a real challenge. We don't have a state system, much less having a federal system. So at this point, I'm not.
And you're not connected to the internet at all?
No.
Yes, Giovanni, for Alameda County. Alameda is a populated county nearby. So this question is early voting. Is there any observer for it? Generally, I don't trust it, so I try to go to the poll. I'd like to know what you think. And also, my girlfriend and I should keep on a statistic of 100% attention. Very small. But when we went online at Alameda, we registered for mail, that worked. And then we had to register four times to go to vote to the poll. It never worked. So then we have to call in. And I start discussing with them. They said, yes, we need to change the flag. Yes, I do that. They were very nice and they did it. And I asked how that can be. Oh, we have a software error, you know. But for how long has it been going? For several years. I said, but while you're a software engineer, you cannot do this in many years. We don't really know. Can I be hired as a software engineer to fix it? Because clearly we have some issues there, and they can give the information how to get hired as a software engineer. It was more of a joke, obviously. I could. describe this closer, I think, what are your comments about this?
The early voting observing is just the same as any other polling. I mean, people can come in and observe. At the remote locations, it's basically, we set up polling locations outside the office, and early voting in our office, which will start Monday, is just voting in our office in Martinez. And it's, I mean, people can observe it. It's pretty basic. I mean, people just come in and get a ballot and vote. So it can happen any time from, you know, morning till night throughout the day, starting on Monday. And as far as the programming issues, I mean, we really don't program to that deep level of detail. So those kinds of issues are programmed more at the state level than they are in our local offices. We can deal with some of those errors where things can get flipped, but we have to go through the state in order to get them fixed.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you could speak to what kind of sharing of best practices you have with other registrar's offices and kind of like what the levels of communication and standardization and things of this nature.
We have state associations, and so we also have a state communication system. So there's a lot of exchange that goes back, not just between the registrars, but staff. So we try and share ideas. Like when we started our early voting, it was new for us this last election. We got ideas from other counties and thoughts. As far as standardization goes, you know, the problem is that you go from counties that have 1,300 voters to LA that has 10 plus million. And so standardizing is very much a challenge in California. I don't know that we talk to counties as much about standardizing as we do about ensuring that there's some level, and I can give you one quick example. When we share elections, so we share a number of elections with Alameda County, we try and ensure that our rules for ballot designations are the same as theirs, that we're gonna come up with the same answer. Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't, but we try and communicate with each other as much as we can.
I wasn't going to say this now, but it was raised at the Department of Homeland Security that wants to get their fingers in the voting process. How about moving the voting process and the funding of it out and separate it from the political process entirely? I know it can't be completely done, but... And also, there's a proposal for a 28th Amendment to repeal Citizens United and related court decisions. How about a 29th Amendment to separate elections from the political process as much as possible, and to state explicitly that all citizens have the right to vote?
I think that, number one, the federal government really doesn't, other than when they provided funds for HAVA, they really don't pay for anything. The state provides a limited amount of funding. Most of it comes directly from our county general funds. As far as eliminating the political process, when I was in the legislature, I introduced bills twice that would have required that the Secretary of State be nonpartisan, just like the superintendent of public instruction, but unfortunately those bills never got anywhere. But I agree with you. I think the standard for those of us that are registrars should be that we are not partisan, we don't play in that sandbox. I think the rule should be the same at the state level. And if for no other reason to give voters a sense of confidence that we're not trying to play favorites.
After the primary, I went in to observe in Alameda County the processing of provisional ballots. There were about 40 people working on screens, each with their own little box of ballots. And they would go from one screen to another, mark the envelopes, sometimes open the envelopes. But we had to stand beyond a certain
boundary, and we could see that they were going from screen to screen, but we didn't know what the heck they were doing. I realize you need to be able to process these ballots, and you can't have observers interfere too much, but is there any way we could have a clearer understanding of what they're doing so that observing really means we're confident that they're counting things correctly?
What we did in our case was we have a separation, but before, for the observers when they first came in, we allowed them to come inside and actually stand with somebody who was processing the provisional ballots and see, this is what I do. This is what I look at first. I check this, and then we check that, and this. So they actually had a chance to see it. Now, for the rest of the time, they had to stay back, but they at least knew at that point what the person was looking at and why they were doing what they were doing.
That's very good. Thank you.
Okay, so I'm hearing you say that you're not online during the voting process, the elections process. I'm also hearing that you communicate results to the Secretary of State and so on. So, but how do those communications happen?
So, our scanning machines are not connected to anything. They scan the ballots, the data is then downloaded onto a disk. That disk is physically removed from the machine and it is walked the 25, 30 feet to another computer where it is inserted into an archaic drive that we have to buy replacement parts for on eBay. And it then is read into that computer. And that's when it actually does the actual count of the ballots off the memory cards. That information is then downloaded onto another disk, which is walked across the hall to a dedicated computer that is connected only to the Secretary of State's office. And that information is then uploaded to the Secretary of State's office. And all that is uploaded is just, these are the results, and that's what goes on the Secretary of State's website on election night. That information at the same time is provided on our website and on a PDF file.
I think I'm gonna need you to say that again. I'm sorry, but it's a lot to take in.
Sure.
That first memory card, can
yes.
you tell me which system it's coming from? Is it MSM? Where
it's coming
from? The
ballot at the polling place is fed into a scanner.
Uh-huh.
That scanner records the vote off of that ballot. That information is on a memory card from the polling place. Those cards are then delivered to the depots on election night. The depots then run them to the elections office. They're in a secure bag. They're taken out of the secure bag. They're double checked against the log to ensure that they're coming from the correct polling place. The information from the memory card is then downloaded onto a computer disk on another computer drive. That then is fed ultimately into a separate computer that actually does the count.
What are the names of those computers? That's where I'm getting.
They're just computers. They're just
whatever.
What are
the names of the systems? Or
see, it's an ESNS. It's a
M100.
It's an M100 and it's just a computer. It's a Dell or whatever we have in the office. It's not connected to anything.
From the polling place to the Dell to the tablet.
It's all by hand. Everything is carried by hand. So the memory card is carried by hand to the office. It's inserted into a drive. All the computer does is read that memory card and then downloads it onto another drive. It's not connected to anything other than a card reader.
And the Secretary of State gets that information from where, how, from which computer?
From a computer that is separate from all of those. And
does it have a name? Is it the system?
It's a computer. I don't know what
it is. It's not a Dell whatsoever.
Probably
a Dell.
Whatever. No,
SMS.
We don't use Dell. No, this is just, there's no magic to this. I mean, basically, we're taking the data and just putting it into a Dell or Compact, whatever it is, and it just sends the data to the Secretary of State's office. It's not
interpreting anything, it's not reading anything, it's just sending the data.
By the internet.
But it's a dedicated, it's one line that does nothing that but connect from our office to the Secretary of State's office.
Right, and then you program the computer, the tabulators, you set them up before the ballots are fed through them. Are they set up? Are they somehow, is there some code entered?
The code is on the ballot, on the paper ballot. The coding is on the tracks on the side. That tells the reader what the race is, and then it reads the bubble that is filled in by the
voter. I'm sorry, I'm trying to understand because our registrar told us that she sets up the computers for each county, the tabulating computers, before the ballots are fed through. And I was wondering if you had a similar system, if some kind of code is entered into the tabulators, or the tabulators somehow set up for the precincts before the ballots are filled through.
Sure.
Many of you know, I'm Maddie, and that I live in ContraCostaCounty, and as an observer, he saw me every day for like 4 weeks. So I'm not defending him. He's his own, he's an adult. But I will just shine some lights on what I saw. So I was also a poll worker. So you're working the polls, everything gets driven to the ROV that night by two people. It gets delivered. That part I don't know. What happens when it gets delivered and who's there, right? Once you show up in the morning, you do your observer duties, you're gonna observe multiple phases. You're gonna see, in our county, the collection of mobile mails, everybody's stacking those up, being behind a cage, keeping them safe, and you have provisionals also being packed up, making sure they're safe, and you got all these boxes of the ballots that have come in from the poll sites. And everything has to be treated in phases, right? You can't start counting the mobile mails and provisionals until all the precincts are counted and where you sign in, that you're registering, that you're voting that day, the roster. Because we don't want to make sure people get accused of voting twice and et cetera. So that's really important key. So once all that is done, then they start processing and they do security checks on the ballots. I mean, on the envelopes, so the provisionals and mobile mails. Those go through almost three levels of supervisory checks. Because they're looking at signatures, addresses, making sure they can vote in that county, in that precinct, and they make corrections along the way. I was so impressed to see that Joe, Scott, Kinopasek, and all these other supervisors, hands-on, went and checked envelopes that their first tier of poll workers were checking and said, I don't know if this signature matches. They went and looked at it, proved it, and went through. There is a small percentage of voters who just either were, I know the confusion of multiple reasons. That's one of the things that I would like to get more details from our county, other county, on why people don't get through, because there's nobody collecting that data. But your question is around machines and connectivity. So, as an observer, we're seeing people, poll workers, who either were a poll worker and now are continuing the process and now process ballots, and they continue as a hired staff. And they are handling the count and removing the ballot from envelopes and all that kind of stuff. So that then gets put in the machine where the machine counts. And those machines aren't connected to anything. We had someone from Santa Mo come and look, who was an IT volunteer, IT specialist, who came and looked and hooked all the machines. And Joe was standing, like a hawk, making sure we didn't touch anything. And because our IT specialist could have been anybody. So I was very appreciative that he was watching us like a hawk, and we were watching these machines like a hawk. And after that, they had these discs. And the disc reads what's on that machine that had just counted these either remade ballots or provisionals or mobile mails. And that takes it to another central computer. And that computer just collects data. At the end of the day, some counties will fax their information to the SOS so that they can upload it on their personal website to see results. And our county waited till Friday. And so if we found that SOS was not processing the facts with the numbers quickly enough. So we were seeing different numbers on SOS, the state page, voting numbers and our local numbers. So I'm going to his staff and saying, what are these numbers different? And he was able to show us the facts for it, that they would send with a stamp and the staff signature. So there was no, that we observed, transfer votes electronically. It was by fax because they printed it out and sent it to SOS. On this situation, SOS was taking very long, maybe 1 week, maybe a week and a half, almost two, till they uploaded our county numbers correctly. So I just wanted to share that in this county, we believe that the process are, you know, the best, but could use some help, and this is why we appreciate that Joe and his office and the staff want to work with us to improve things. And we want them in Santa Clara County to also set a model, because they're willing to work with us. So all your questions are amazing, because that's going to make them think, right, about how to improve things. And after the election, get what? He goes to a national conference with other states where he gets to have a voice for us. So you really want to work at the county level with your ROV, because they go to these conferences and talk to each other, and they try to standardize things. They're just not quite there yet. So,
Patty, thank you. So the problem with observing, being an observer, is I can't see what's going on in the machines. So that's what I'm trying to understand, because I'm also seeing inconsistency with what goes into them and what comes out, and there is no way I can observe that. So I would really love to see elections being counted at poll places on election night, as they historically have been, by human beings. Just count them and then communicate that to the central registry.
My question is on a little bit different part of this. There's a California Association of Registrar of Voters, Registrars of Voters. So I would like to hear a little bit about what that organization is and how it runs, how often you meet, how you select your officers. I know there's a president, a vice president, a treasurer, and then also how you communicate or delay, or what your relationship is with the Secretary of State.
We have a state association, California Association of Clerks and Election Officials. It's like any other trade association. The officers are selected by the members, nominating committee. I'm on the board of directors. I'm not an officer, but I'm on the board. And we meet a couple times a year.
There's different committees also. So once a month, we meet in Sacramento. We share, depending on the committee, you know, what the one county is doing, what other county is going to be doing, all the new laws are implemented, how it's going to affect the practice in our county. We share ideas, see what's working, what didn't work.
So those of us that are registrars and the principals, we meet together probably 2 to 3 times a year. And then the rest of the time, the staff works in committees. There's legislation, there's operations, there's voter registration, so there are different committees that meet and exchange ideas throughout the year.
And the things that you're deciding about and discussing are perhaps issues that are coming up that we're talking about today, or what types?
There are discussions. Decisions, I think, is probably too generous a term. Like getting any group of people together that are all independent, getting everybody to agree on a common course of action is oftentimes a challenge. So, you know, basically, we try and reach a consensus on issues like legislation and things like that, and then we share best practices. But there's no policy that says that the state association is mandating that you do X, Y, or Z. So it doesn't work that way.
How often do you vote on your new officers? Like how what is it term for?
2 years.
Okay.
Yeah, 2 years. regular terms
is
of office.
Is there a vice president?
Yes, there's a president, a vice president, secretary,
and
deputy treasurer.
Those are all separate
functions. Yeah, Dean Logan is your president, the registrar.
Who's the vice president?
Neil was, Orange County was the immediate past president. I think Donna Johnson, no, she's the Reporters Association. I don't remember. I failed.
And Sue Redishak?
Could be.
Sue Redishak, and we don't know what her office is.
She could be the vice president this year. Yeah.
Okay, two more questions. One mayor, we're running up on lunch.
Hi, I just want to say that, well, first of all, I have been a Bernie Sanders supporter. I still am. Anyway, I went to Southern California to go to the Still Sanders rally, and Stephen Stokes, I don't know if you're familiar with him, but he was on the ballot running against Nancy Pelosi. So he's officially on the ballot. And he said, and I saw him in his own words, say that when he went to vote, his name was not even on the voting rolls. And he lives in Los Angeles. He's running for U.S. Senator. His vote was not even, I mean, his name was not there. And neither was the street that he lives on, which is a real popular street in Los Angeles. So he went and got a lawyer and had to work with a lawyer for about 2 or 3 hours to get this straightened out. So he didn't mark the wrong box. I don't know what happened to him. But if somebody like who's running for senator isn't on the rolls, I mean, just think about the rest of us. And I am 71 years old. I voted my whole life. And I am so discouraged about the election system at this point. And, you know, I don't even feel like I want to vote in this next election because all what it seems to be a lot of fraudulent stuff going on and cheating and this and the other. So I would like to have this mail-in system, which I think, would that bypass these voting machines that, you know, we're suspect of and have been suspect of for the last at least 16 years? Because I would like to bypass them. I wish we could eradicate them, you know, get rid of them. We don't trust them.
Yeah, again, we don't use the voting machines other than the machines that count the dots on the ballot, so it's probably it's a different system in LA. They still use punch card ballots, so it's a different process.
Is open source ever thought of as an alternative or checked? I know they did it in Humboldt County with this tracking system. Is there any discussion in that area? There's always been a question. I know in your case, you guys actually program your own code, but in a lot of areas in the United States and even California, it's private companies that are coming in with proprietary code.
Well, Dean Logan in LA has been working on his own in-house system, and it's an open source concept. I would really like to have new technology or new system or something, but we're not. In our county, we're not rushing into anything because I don't know what the voting systems are going to look like. So if there is an open source that ultimately comes out, I would prefer that over a proprietary system, which I think provides for exorbitant costs and all sorts of other issues anyway. But we'll just have to wait and see. No one's come up with one yet, and Dean in LA is probably as close as anyone so far.
Right, last question.
Thanks for being here today. I'm from Santa Clara County, and in 08 I was an election official. And for those of you from Santa Clara County, that means I ran a polling station. So at that time, I need to sign up to work again. I'm sorry, I'm a student, so I'm not going to stay.
I will take your name.
Okay, that's fine. But I'm a part of a group in Santa Clara County, and we were wondering why when I was an election, when I ran the polling station in 08, we divided up the county ballots and we hand counted them. I think we did it a couple times with witnesses and then we passed them in. What is the chance that Santa Clara can go back to that? Since there's, overall questions about election integrity. I'm not saying in Santa Clara County, but I was just wondering why we don't do that anymore. And
this was 2008?
Yes.
We still do the same thing? Nothing has changed.
I was told that ballots are not counted.
You
you are not counting results. You open the ballot box and you count how many cards you have. But you're not counting ballots. You're not saying this candidate got so many votes, this candidate. We are not doing that at the precinct level.
I don't remember if we counted the candidate votes, but we did separate them.
You just separated them.
Yes, but I don't think we did an official.
Are you counting for total voters?
You're counting for total voters. So at the end of the night, if you have 100 signatures, you want to have 100 ballots. And that's basically what you're doing. You're doing a balance. Make sure that you receive so many ballots in the polling place. So many are in use, so many were used. This is the number of voters. But you're not counting votes. The tally is done at the office. We're still doing things the same way.
So we, it's just, we, I remember specifically that we divided up the ballots by candidates. So is that an official count?
It was, is that primary election?
Or? No, this was the presidential election in LA.
Yeah, there's no reason for you to separate.
Okay.
It should close at 2 a.m. in the morning?
No, we actually close pretty early.
No, we don't separate. You don't do any tally of the polls.
Okay.
All right. Big hand for Karin. Okay, it's lunchtime, and there's an announcement.
Just can you guys tell us when the deadline is for signing up high school poll workers? Because I think it's coming up. And also reiterate the need for high school teachers just to spread to our people online. We need high school teachers all over the place to be the liaisons, and then also if there's a deadline for high school poll workers.
There's no real deadline other than I'd say probably November 5th because that'll be our last training session. So for high school students, we're just going to take as many as we can up until that deadline of November 5th. And then for teachers, we're in the same boat. It really is critical to have the teacher. And if we have the teacher, then it helps with the kids.
Yeah, so we're telling like thousands of people out there. If you know any teachers in high schools,
if there are teachers out there that are interested, if you know teachers in high schools that are willing to engage, that's an absolutely critical part of this whole process. Because without the teacher, then we don't get the kids to come along. So it's critical.
Thank you.
We're going to come back in half an hour and get going again. So we'd like our speakers that have arrived to get in line first, because we need you to chew up and get back here. Okay? Second, we're low on cash to make reimbursements for lunch today. So if you have cash, please go ahead of the line so we can get people who don't have change to check out. Lunch is $8 and includes your plate and drink. And if you are lacking funds, please don't, well, no one's going to be turned away. Those of you who want to pitch in a little bit more to help us cover folks who are lacking funds, please do. You know, instead of $8, just throw in your whole 10. We'd appreciate that. Thank you very much. We'll start again. You're actually going to get 10 extra minutes. So we're going to have 40 minutes. So we'll see you all back here by 1:30. I sure will go. Thank you.